So now discuss how the AC voltage that was generated or that is generated in through the basic movement of the coil inside the magnetic field, as we discussed in the last video and in the first topic of this chapter, how that AC voltage can be converted into a DC voltage. Now, all of you, of course, have taken semiconductor devices, or some of you have taken power electronics, where we discussed that the rectifier circuits can be used to convert the AC voltage into a DC voltage, and then we can improve the shape of the DC voltage using filters, using the capacitive filters. Now, in power systems, of course, everything is done at a very high energy level, at a very high voltage and current. And generally, we don't use the microelectronic circuits that we have discussed. So the first thing actually is to convert the AC voltage into DC voltage. And this DC voltage, when you convert it, it is not a smooth DC voltage, but it is a unidirectional voltage, as against this voltage, which is bidirectional voltage, which is an AC voltage. So what is how do we make changes to the original design to achieve that? It is very straightforward. Remember, in the original design, you have the loop of wire or conductor, you have the north and south, a permanent magnet or electromagnet, and then you had the two slip rings. I can move up again. Oops, to back. Okay. And we have two slip rings, one connected to one side of coil, the other connected to the other side of the coil, and then of course we have carbon brushes. So everything remains same, except we remove slip rings, or at least we remove one slip ring, and then the other slip ring we cut in half, isolate from each other using some insulator so they are not electrically touching each other, and then the connection of each side of the coil is, the connectors are now moving inside this slip ring, and this is called commutator. So this arrangement of one slip ring cut in half, and slip ring can be cut in many pieces based on how smooth the voltage is going to be and how many conductors are going to be there, as we will see shortly. But just the basic idea is that you take the slip ring, you cut it in half, you insulate each side from the other side, and then inside that your conductors are moving. So now it is not connected to the same, each side is not connected to the same slip ring. It is moving inside. That means side AB at this time, in this orientation, side AB is connected on top, the top side of the slip ring or commutator, connected to the brush X, and side DC is connected at the bottom, connected to brush Y. Okay, now when the coil is going to move, let's say move 180 degrees, then side AB is going to be under south pole of the magnet, and the conductor is going to be touching at the bottom of the commutator. So it is changing the side of the commutator which it will be touching based on the position of the conductor. It is not always touching the same conductor or same slip ring or same commutator. And at that time, side CD is going to be under north, and it's going to be touching on top of the conductor. So if we take our load voltage again, E load, we take positive on top and negative at the bottom. What's going to happen? That at this instant of time, you have two E, again, we discussed the E induced, so I don't have to go in that discussion again. You have two E induced, the value of E load. 2E induced from X to Y, right? Now it is going to move, of course, 90 degree. The output is going to be zero, as we discussed. And it is going to move 180 degrees. Now DC is under north and AB is under south, but they are also touching the opposite sides of commutator. So DC is touching the top side and AB is touching the bottom side. So now Y is going to have 2E induced voltage with respect to X, or for our reference load voltage measurement, that is from X to Y, it is going to be negative 2E induced. From X to Y, it is going to be still positive 2 induced. From Y to X is going to be negative 2 induced, because we are changing the conductor that the side is connected to. So now when you move it 180 degrees, DC is connected to the top side of the commutator, and AB is connected to the bottom. Now remember, in AB you had the E induced voltage from positive to negative on this side, irrespective which conductor is on this side, and on this side you have positive negative E induced, again irrespective which conductor is on the north side. So now when the CD is under the north side, it is also touching the top of the commutator, so the voltage from X to Y will always be 2E induced. So it's going to go 2E induced, start 2E induced, go down to zero, and then start increasing again and become 2E induced again after 180 degrees. So this cycle will keep on going, as you can see in this diagram, in this figure. 2E induced when side AB was under north, and then again 2E induced when side CD was under north. And when it moves, of course, 90 degrees, the velocity vector is going to be parallel to your flux density vector, and the cross product of those two are going to be zero. What else we are seeing? So this is how it's going to convert the bidirectional voltage into unidirectional voltage. That's how it is going to change. Now still it's not a smooth DC. So how to make the voltage a smooth DC? And again, look at this figure, it's going to show you how it is converting. So how to improve the shape of the voltage? Let's go and look at this figure. Now in this arrangement, you have two sets of coils. So you have a red one and you have a black one. The commutator is divided into four sections now, and each section is going to be insulated from the other section. You still have two carbon brushes, a green one as you see, and a white one, this one. The red coil is moving inside the commutator, as well as the coil that is basically perpendicular to the red coil, which is the black coil or the white coil, is again moving inside the commutator. It's not connected to commutator, it is just moving inside the commutator. So each coil is going to be touching different part of commutator based on its orientation. So as you see, at this time, a specific time, there is no voltage induced in the red coil, because the velocity vector of the red coil, again, it's going to be, this side is going, let's say, in this direction, and this side is going in this direction. And the white coil or the black coil, it's the same case as we saw earlier. So you will have some voltage induced on the two sides of the black, and that voltage is going to be the maximum voltage E induced, 2E induced. And that voltage is gonna go, as you can see the dotted line, it's going to change, because it's a commutator, it's going to change along this dotted line. And right now, there's no voltage induced in the red one, so it is at zero, this point. And then it will start increasing when it will be 90 degrees, when it will move 90 degrees, then it will be in the same orientation as the black coil. So the voltage will be induced in this coil, and that voltage is going to be 2E induced when it will be in the same position as the black coil. That is, the velocity vector is going to be perpendicular to the flux density vector. and the voltage will start inducing before that, of course, because again it depends on the orientation of the coil, but the maximum voltage will be when it will be parallel, the area of the coil will be parallel to the flux, or the area vector will be perpendicular to the flux density vector, and area itself is going to be parallel to the flux density, or the velocity vector is going to be perpendicular to the flux density vector. So what's happening over here is you are basically having this arrangement of two coils. You are basically not letting the voltage dip down all the way to zero and then come back again. Basically, your voltage is now induced in the coil, two different coils, but when it will be taken out and connected to the load right here, then again, since different parts of the coil will be touching different parts of the commutator segment along their way to when they're moving in the counterclockwise or clockwise direction, then the voltage X with respect to Y is always going to be, first of all, positive value, and it will not dip all the way down to zero. And basically now your pulses in the DC voltage, in the unidirectional voltage, your pulses width or height have been reduced by introducing this arrangement of commutator, that is more segments of the commutator and more coils, right? So what you're learning here is, if you can extend this this arrangement, that is, if you have multiple coils in the armature, this is called the armature of the generator with the coil. Now, if you have multiple coils in the armature of the generator and you have multiple sections of your commutator, multiple segments of the commutator, which are of course isolated from each other, then this shape is going to improve. That is, if you have multiple segments of the coil, it is possible that it's not even go down to the point A, or the point A will not be that further down. It's possible it just goes down a very little bit, like this. So the more commutator segments you have and the more coils that you have, basically that will help to sustain the voltage to the same level or close to that level. So what exactly you're doing? You are basically giving you the analogy of the rectifier circuits. You are basically introducing the capacitive filter at the output of the full wave rectifier, let's say. So full wave rectifier output was this output. And then as you start applying a capacitive filter with proper values, your capacitor can hold on to the voltage for the time that the value of the AC voltage or the unidirectional DC voltage goes down and comes back up. It can hold on to the voltage such that it's not going down all the way to zero. And as you start choosing the value of capacitor, better value of capacitor, then the RC time constant, the time that it requires to discharge the capacitor, is going to be quite larger as compared to the frequency of the voltage. Hence, by the time by the time it will discharge a little bit, you know, the next cycle is going to arrive. So same analogy over here, but we are not using any capacitor. We are not doing a microelectronic circuit. Instead, we are using commutator, many segments of commutator. We still use two carbon brushes, remember, but many segments of commutator and many coils. And that helps us, that arrangement helps us to improve the shape of the waveform. It's going to be DC, and it will have a lot less variation, a lot less pulses, and it may become pretty smooth DC voltage. So you can go and read for loop. It's a little hard to understand it. When I put it in here, I explained it, you know, and you can read the explanation. I'm not going to go over it since you get the idea what's going on. But it's a little bit tricky to understand as compared to the two loop generator that I explained. Two loop is pretty easy to understand. But this is basically the arrangement that we do in the generator by increasing the number of commutator segments and by increasing the number of coils, you can achieve relatively less or relative DC voltage with or a DC voltage with less pulse height, or perhaps zero pulse height.